On the oceans and upon high seas, fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy me. Oh, things ain't what they used to be. Radiation underground and in the sky, animals and birds who live nearby.
Mercy, mercy me. Marvin Gaye here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. The War and Peace Report. We're broadcasting on over 800 stations on Pacific and NPR and low-power FM and college and community radio stations, on public access TV and PBS TV stations, and both TV satellite networks on Dish Network Channel 9415, Free Speech TV, 9410 Link TV, and on DirecTV Channel 375. And we're video and audio podcasting at democracynow.org. Our headlines are also available in Spanish for any radio station to take, as over 250 are. We're looking forward to meeting some of the people and many of the radio stations, because Democracy Now! Is headed to Cochabamba, Bolivia. We're going to be covering the climate change summit that is being called by the president of Bolivia, Evo Morales, and many community organizations in Bolivia and around Latin America. We'll be broadcasting there all next week. But right now, we're turning to a health issue here in this country. Sharif?
That's right. We're going to look at the health impacts of natural gas drilling as the Environmental Protection Agency begins its review of how the drilling process known as hydraulic fracking or hydraulic fracturing or fracking can affect drinking water quality. The gas industry is raising new objections. The Independent Petroleum Association of America told the EPA its intended research, quote, goes well beyond relationships between hydraulic fracturing and drinking water. The findings could lead Congress to repeal an exemption that shields the fracturing process from federal regulation under the Safe Drinking Water Act.
Well, as the debate over shale gas drilling heats up, we're joined here in New York by Dr. Theo Colborn, zoologist and president of the Endocrine Disruption Exchange. She's one of the foremost experts on health and environmental effects of the toxic chemicals used in fracking fluid. Welcome to Democracy Now!, Dr. Colborn.
Amy, it's great to be here with you.
Well, it's great to have you in our studio. Start off by explaining what fracking is. What is hydraulic fracturing?
Well, you know, you first have to drill a hole. And the fracking goes one step beyond drilling the hole. In other words, the gas comes up out of the hole, but eventually you want to get more gas. And to facilitate that, there's now a technology called fracking. Actually, industry calls it stimulating, and that's to make it more, you know, citizen public-wise, it's acceptable. But basically, it causes many earthquakes underneath the ground. They put chemicals in large amounts of fluids. Basically, if you're going to be drilling in the New York City watershed, say, you're going to be using between 3 and 8 million gallons of water, which may be carrying tons of toxic chemicals that eventually no one really knows where they're going to go. Now, when they fracture, as they go down in the hole, the chemicals are added over a sequence of time because they're put in there for various purposes. But when the little mini explosion takes place underground, that may extend as far as 2,000 feet out from the borehole. And consequently, that extends then this ability of this fracturing process to work. Now, that's from a direct drilled pipe, and we've been using that process for years. More recently, they've gone into what they call horizontal fracturing, where as they drill the pipe down in, they bend the pipe so that the pipe then goes up horizontally below the ground, and that can extend another 2,000 feet. So the beauty of fracturing, of course, is that you don't have to make as many perforations on the ground above where the people are living, but you also have this access to maybe a radius of a mile or more around where each borehole goes in to the ground.
Well, let's turn to a clip from this documentary, Split Estate, that investigates fracking. This clip features Weston Wilson, an environmental engineer in the EPA's Denver office. In 2004, Wilson openly questioned an EPA study that declared fracking poses little or no threat to drinking water.
The former chairman, CEO of Halliburton, Dick Cheney, within a few months of coming into office, and as vice president, he was pressuring the administrator of EPA, Christy Todd Whitman, to exempt hydraulic fracking from the Safe Drinking Water Act regulation. From my own point of view as a technician, I just thought it very alarming that EPA technically had described how toxic these materials are, toxic at the point of injection, and still come out with a summary that says they don't need to be reported or regulated. And that led me, in the fall of 2004, to object on technical grounds. Then the Inspector General of EPA began an investigation of my complaints. And several months into that, Congress took the report from EPA saying that fracking did not present a risk, along with other information, and exempted hydraulic fracking from regulation under the Safe Drinking Water Act. That leaves you and I, as the American public, in this position. We cannot know what the industry injects in our land. It is exempt from being reported.
That was Weston Wilson, an environmental engineer in the EPA's Denver office, speaking in 2004. Dr. Theo Colborn, your thoughts on what he was saying in this issue of disclosure.
Well, exactly. It's very interesting. We've been trying to get information on the chemicals that are used to fracture, drilling and fracturing. Drilling has its problems as well. We must not overlook that. And over the years, with the help of government data and then also information that we've basically collected because of accidents and spills, we've been able to put together a database in which we have 944 products listed now that are being used in the states where natural gas activity is taking place. Now, out of those 944 chemicals, we know between 95 and 100% of about 14% of the chemicals that are being used. We know what they are in those products. But we also have 43% of the products that are being used, we know absolutely nothing. We have no idea what's in those 42-gallon drums or those 350 or 60-gallon totes. So we're dealing with the information that we're working with is only based on a very small percentage of the products that are being used.
So let's talk about the health. Go ahead.
But the problem here is what Wes is talking about is 70%, 30 to 70% of that water that's injected underground can possibly come back up to the surface. No one knows exactly how much stays underground and how much is going to be coming back up to the surface. So you worry about the long-term effect of that material that's staying underground that could appear later coming up in rivers and streams, at people's well sites, that sort of thing, because we don't understand the geology underground. But then all that, the rest of that has to come back up. And what people don't realize is that gas doesn't come up out of the ground dry either. It comes up wet. So we have the water we're taking off of the gas. It is not clean. And we have the water that's coming back up from fracturing.
We don't have much time, but we want to talk about the health effects. You are the president of the Endocrine Disruption Exchange.
That's right.
Explain what endocrine disruption is and how that relates to these chemicals that you are beginning to identify.
Well, it's amazing, Amy. We were really stunned when we began breaking out the chemicals by their major health effects, and we found that 43% of the chemicals in Colorado And those that are used there are endocrine disruptors. Now, and in our national survey, it's 37%. But what endocrine disruption does, basically, these are the chemicals that we now understand better, by the way, that are made from natural gas, believe it or not, the plastics that and pesticides and other industrial chemicals. These are the chemicals that can get into the pregnant woman and enter the womb while her baby is developing in her womb and alter how those children are born. And this is our big concern today because we're facing major pandemics of endocrine-driven disorders, simple things like ADHD, ADHD.